So, welcome. My name is Dustin. I'm working for OpenNMS and I'm also a student at the University of Fulda. And yeah, for the University of Fulda, we, some friends of mine and I, have done some research on how to correlate syslog messages and getting some useful information out of it. And yeah, that's what I want to talk about. Today's syslog setups are, beside all that stuff that's going on with Flume and Logstash and all that other stuff, is a classical centralized syslog server receiving all the syslog messages from all the hosts in your network, sending them to the central server, and the central server just stores them on the on a whatever kind of storage. Sometimes it's plain files, sometimes it's some kind of database. And yeah, you have some kind of monitoring and analysis system just getting back the data and scrolling through it, and you have to find the relevant messages. So what we've done is, may you know about rules, it's also included in OpenNMS. As a correlation engine, and it allows you to have some kind of working memory. I think Jeff has explained it as some kind of whiteboard where you can put some notes on it, and there are some rules working on that notes. And what these rules can do is they have a left side, it's like a where clause or a when statement or an if statement, and they always check if they're is some special constitu some special group of things on the whiteboard, and if they match, they will do some action. And it's highly efficient using the Ricci algorithm, and it's quite nice to work with that. And during the last year, there was an extension for this Jules engine called Jules Fusion, which allows you to add something like a timestamp to this thing you put on the whiteboard, and then it gets some kind of event. And you can do temporal reasoning on it and say, if you have an event like that, followed by another event within 5 minutes or something like that, then do that action. And it allows you to put in some kind of sliding windows over your events. And another cool thing of this is, because you have this time component in your events, it can automatically get rid of all this outdated stuff on your whiteboard, and yeah, you don't have to care about that, it gets rid automatically. What we've also used for storing the log files in this prototype is Elasticsearch. It's an fancy NoSQL document store. The document store is quite nice for storing syslogs because, as you will see later, we have built some mechanism to gather more information out of the syslog by parsing or by using external systems and getting information in it. And it's quite nice to store them in the document store because it's schema-free and you don't have to know which fields are available for your particular syslog message. You can just put it into the store and it stores it, and it's fine. Another cool thing about syslog is, it has some automatically cluster features, and you can just put in another node if you can't handle I/O anymore. And it's really cool to work with that because it has a nice REST API for getting the data back, and it's really, really fast. We've done some experiments with millions of syslog messages. Searching for string is a few milliseconds task in it, and you can just do as you type permanent searching on it. So what we've done is we've created a small prototype gluing all these things together. This prototype receives the syslog messages, puts it to rules, and ties the rules working memory and the Elasticsearch database together so that every event inserted into the rules memory is also inserted in the Elasticsearch database. Yeah. For that, we're using RSS lock because it has some really nice features about parsing messages and formatting messages and forwarding them. So the first thing we've configured is we use liblognorm for parsing the messages. It's a really nice tool. It's easy to integrate into rsyslog because it's done by the rsyslog project, sub-project. And we've configured rsyslog to build a JSON string out of the fields from the syslog messages and just forward it to our prototype using TCP protocols, line protocol is it in hand. So we're heavily using liblognorm to make sense of all these fields in a syslog message. Let's say you have an SSH login and there is the IP address in it and there is the port in it and the username in it. And I will show an example later on how easy it is to get all this information out of the message without doing nasty things with regex expressions and stuff like that. So here again is the workflow. We are just receiving the message using TCP, parsing it in Java object. It's all written in Java. Just place it in the working memory, and then rules come up and fire the rules engines, fire the rules, and they're changing things in the working memory, and all these changing things are reflected in the Elasticsearch database. That means if you update a message later on, maybe you have gathered some additional information on this message, this update is also reflected to the Elasticsearch database. We then do an update of the record in the database queue. So that's an easy example of one of these liblognorm. One of these liblognorm rules. We just use it as an example to try to detect SSR brute force attacks and especially successful SSH brute force attacks. So here you can see it's just placing things like that into the string of the message itself and it gets passed out of it. And it will be available later on as a separated field called username. And if you have ever tried to pass IP addresses using regular expressions, that's much easier than doing it with regex. So that's the data we get into our prototype directly from our syslog. And it contains all the common stuff, like the timestamp, the host name, everything that's common to a common syslog message. But what's special is this data structure. It's all the data gathered from liblognorm. And we also have the rule name. I can show it again. It's just this rule name, like that. It's also included in the message down here. So, and that on the lower half is what you have to do to put rules in this event mode. You can just say, okay, I have this time field in my data structure and just use that as a timestamp to make it an event. Come in. And that's the first part of one of the rules we are using in rules to detect brute force attempts. What it does, it just says, give me all the messages or collect all the messages in a list where all the messages have the tag SSH failure set, that was a failed login, and have the same host name and has the same user. Over a time window from 1 minute, and just fire that rule if we have more than 10 of them into in this window. And what we do in the rule is fairly easy. We just retract all the messages in this time window, which means they're deleted from the Elasticsearch database and are removed from the working memory, and then just generate a new message saying, okay, this is a condensed messages, meaning there was 10 messages in before, just to save some space. And what we do in the next step is, it's another rule. We are searching for a brute force attempt having these two stacks set. And then we're searching for an SSH successful login message from the same host. And if we have both of them coming after another, this is what this below means. If we have a successful login message in the time range of 10 seconds after a brute force attempt, then we will rewrite this message and update it and say, okay, this is a successful brute force attempt. And that's how it looks like. You can see it's it contains, or it shows the brute force attempt message, and then 10 seconds we have successful login, and it says, okay, it was a successful brute force attempt. By the way, this log viewer is something we're working on currently, to having something dynamically filterable working together with Elasticsearch, which also without using all the fancy new technologies and just using existing syslog setups. So we also have done some performance measurements. There is a Elasticsearch plugin in our syslog in the latest versions. You can directly use our syslog to write into Elasticsearch. And as you can see, our prototype is nearly 2 times faster than the existing Elasticsearch integration of our syslog. The reason for that is we're using the native protocol and we don't use REST requests for that. And our prototype itself becomes a part of the cluster of the Elasticsearch nodes, but has a special flag set, don't store your own data, and then it just publishes the data into the cluster and it gets stored by other nodes. And that gives us a huge performance improvement. And on the left side, on the right side, this bar is our prototype with correlation enabled, and we are just as fast as MySQL or Elasticsearch nowadays. So that's nearly it. All the code is available on GitHub. I think I will just publish the slides later on in the event system if you're interested in it. There are a lot of things hard-coded and there's a lot of stuff to do. But there's an example configuration included and you can just check it out, change the connection port to an Elasticsearch cluster and recompile it, and then it should run. As I said, there are a lot of things left to do. What we're currently trying to implement is gathering even more information about the message from external sources like the inventory system or like OpenNMS. We are also planning to, from the tools engine, path some kinds of events to other system, not syslog itself, let's say OpenNMS. And we have to write some documentation for that. What would be also really nice is to have some kind of shared repository for all the libloknow messages, because it can be a pain in the ass to write them and test them. And let's say an Apache syslog or Apache log message looks the same everywhere. Maybe we can build a shared repository for that where everybody can contribute and share their libloknow rules. Yeah, that's it. I have to say thank you to the team, Coach Spitzengruppe, especially Christian and Sven sitting there, because they have done a lot of research on that too. So, are there any questions? Why not? As I said, the big benefit is the document store. It makes things very, very easy. And for us, it was easier to scale out than things like MongoDB. Yeah, it was perfect fit because it was also really, really nice to have some to search on the system of messages, have all these auto-completion features. It's really easy to build a web interface for that, which just says, okay, you start typing and it gives you auto-completion data back and allows you stuff like that. It's really, really easy to gather, what's it called, datagram information about how much messages per type I've seen over the time. Yeah, and it's quite fast.
Can start with a small self-installation and then scale it out. When you
Yeah.
start with MongoDB, for example, you need a free cluster, a free node cluster because of the consensus nodes. And with Search, it's easy to start with a single node and then scale out when it's needed.
How did you find Drupal over, say, Logstash or something similar? Why did you pick Drupal?
I picked Drools because it was the, or it is the only correlation engine I'm aware of that supports this temporal reasoning feature very well.
Yeah, so that seems for
And
me that's a good feature.
that's really nice for log messages.
Yeah.
You have a lot of situations where you just want to say this type followed by that, and it's really easy to write it down that way.
Does Drupal allow you to export to different locations? So, for example, our Logstash will send to Graphite as well as Elasticsearch, for example. Does Drupal have that? I mean, I suppose we could possibly integrate that with Logstash, so Logstash sends to Drupal.
Yeah, not I don't think not by default, because Jules is just only correlation
It's
agent,
just the
generic
engine,
one. I haven't looked into a Logstash, but I know it's very similar to Flume, and for Flume it's very easy to write extensions. I think it's the same for Logstash. Shouldn't be too hard to integrate it into Logstash. Yeah, it would also be nice if you have a up-to-date tools version into OpenMMS. Who's you has attended to the advanced training? You remember the things Jeff does with the timing stuff, collecting all that stuff. It's much easier to write it down that way. Any further questions? If you want to get some more information or need some help, feel free to write me an email. I will publish the slides on the presentation tool. There's some references included, including the latest paper we've written about that. And feel free to use it and don't hesitate to ask me if you have some questions.
What was the most interesting use case you had for this?
The thing we've used for all the prototyping was the SSH stuff. I'm not really sure, or I can't. I've seen a lot of situations where I've thought it would be cool to have something like that, but I've never implemented that far. As I said, it's more a prototype thing. So if you have some ideas, let me hear it and maybe I can implement it just for testing or something like that. That one or? So, I think we have 10 minutes left to lunch. Okay, thank you very much.